The extant myths of the Sumerians and Akkadians revolve primarily about the creation and organization of the universe, the origin of the gods, their epic tales, their ancient sites and intrigues, their astronomical achievements, their creative building projects for the gods. The Sumer-Akkadian myths rarely revolve around the struggle for power between the gods, and even then, the struggle is not usually depicted as a bitter, vindictive, and godly conflict. Intellectually, the Sumer-Akkadian myths reveal a relatively mature and sophisticated approach to the gods' religious activities. Behind them can be recognized as considerable theological and cosmological reflection. No Sumerian myths have been recovered dealing directly and explicitly with the creation of the universe. What little is known about the Sumerian cosmogonic ideas has been inferred and deduced from laconic statements scattered throughout the literary documents. We have several myths concerned with the organization of the universe and its cultural processes, the creation of man, and the establishment of civilization. The deities involved in these myths are relatively few: the air god Enlil, the water god Enki, the mother goddess Ninhursag, also known as Nin and Ninma, the god of the south wind Ninurta, the moon god Nanasin, the Eridu god Martu, and above all the goddess Inanna, particularly concerning her unlucky spouse Dumuzi. Enlil was the most important deity of the Sumerian pantheon, the father of the gods, the king of heaven and earth, the king of all the lands. According to the myth, Enlil and the creation of the pickaxe, he was the god who separated heaven from earth, brought up the seed of the land from the earth, brought forth whatever was needful, fashioned the pickaxe for agricultural and building purposes, and presented it to the people of Dilmun, the Sumerians, or perhaps humankind. According to the myth, summer and winter, Enlil was the god who brought forth all trees and grains, produced abundance and prosperity in the land, and appointed winter as the farmer of the gods, in charge of the life-producing water and of all that grows. The gods, even the most important among them, are all eager for his blessing. After building his sea house in Eridu, one myth relates how the water god Enki journeyed to Enlil's temple in Nippur to obtain his approval and benediction. When the moon god Nanasin, the astronomy deity of Ur, wants to ensure the well-being and prosperity of his domain, he journeys to Nippur on a boat loaded with gifts and thus obtains Enlil's generous blessing. Although Enlil is the chief of the Sumerian pantheon, his powers are not unlimited and absolute. One of the more human and tender of the Sumerian myths concerns Enlil's banishment to the netherworld and tells the following story. When the man had not yet been created, and the city of Nippur was inhabited by gods alone, its young man was the Enlil, its young maid was the goddess Ninlil, and its old woman was Ninlil's mother, Nunbarshangunu. One day the latter, having set her mind and heart on Ninlil's marriage to Enlil, instructs her daughter thus: "In the pure night sky, look up to the stars, Ninlil, walk along the bank of the stream, Nunbirdu. The bright-eyed, the lord, the bright-eyed, the great mountain, Father Enlil, the bright-eyed will see you, the shepherd who decrees the fates, the bright-eyed will see you, will forthwith embrace." Ninlil joyfully follows the instructions. The woman looks up at the stars. In the pure stream, Ninlil walks along the bank of the stream, Nunbirdu, the bright-eyed, the lord, the bright-eyed. The great mountain, Father Enlil, the bright-eyed saw her, the shepherd who decrees the fates, the bright-eyed saw her. After that, Enlil calls his vizier, Nusku and tells him of his desire for the astronomer Ninlil. Nusku brings up a boat, and Ninlil gives Ninlil the gift of the moon god Sin. The gods are dismayed by this immoral deed, and though Ninlil is their king, they seize him and banish him from the city to the netherworld. The relevant passage, one of the few to shed some indirect light on the organization of the pantheon and its method of operation, reads, Ninlil walks about in the Kyr, Ninlil's private shrine. As Ninlil walks about in Kyr, the great gods, the 50 of them, of Igigi fame, the fate-decreeing gods, the 7 of them, sees Ninlil in the Kyr, saying, Ninlil, immoral one, get you out of the city. Nunamnir, an epithet of Ninlil, an immoral one, get you out of the city. Thus, Ninlil, under the fate decreed by the gods, departs the Sumerian Hades. Ninlil, however, now refuses to remain behind and follows Ninlil on his forced journey to the netherworld. This disturbs Ninlil, for it would mean that his son Sin, destined initially to oversee the largest luminous body, the moon, would have to dwell in the dark, gloomy netherworld instead of in the sky. To circumvent this, he seems to devise this somewhat complicated scheme. On the way to Hades from Nippur, he meets up with 3 individuals, minor deities no doubt, the gatekeeper in charge of the Nippur gates, the man of the netherworld river, and the ferryman, the Sumerian Charon, who ferries the dead across to Hades. Ninlil takes the form of each of these, the first known examples of divine metamorphosis, and impregnates Ninlil with 3 netherworld deities as substitutes for their older brother Sin, who is thus free to ascend to heaven. One of the more detailed and revealing of the Sumerian myths concerns the universe's organization by Ninlil, the Sumerian water god, who was also the god of wisdom. The myth begins with a hymn of praise addressed to Enki, which exalts Enki as the god who watches over the universe and handles the fertility of fields, farms, flock, and herds. There follows a pace of self-glorification put into the mouth of Enki and concerned primarily with his relationship to the leading deities of the pantheon, Ninlil and Nintu, and to the lesser gods known collectively as the Anunnaki. Following a brief 5-line passage that tells of the Anunnaki doing homage to Enki, Enki utters a paean of self-glorification for a second time. He begins by exalting the power of his word and command in providing the earth with prosperity and abundance. Continues with a description of the splendor of his shrine, the Abzu, and concludes with an account of his joyous journey over the marshland in his Makuru boat, the ibex of the Abzu, after which the lands Magan, Dilmun, and Meluha sent their heavily laden boats to Nippur with rich gifts for Ninlil. Then the Anunnaki once again pay homage to Enki, particularly as the god who rides and directs the Nerta, the divine laws which govern the universe. The poet now introduces a description of the various rites and rituals performed by some of the more important priests and spiritual leaders of Sumer in Ninlil's Abzu shrine. Beginning, as might have been expected with Sumer itself, he first exalts it as a chosen, hallowed land with lofty and untouchable Ninurta, where the gods have taken up their abode, then blesses its flocks and herds, its temples and shrines. From Sumer, he proceeds to Ur, which he extols in lofty, metaphorical language and blesses with prosperity and preeminence. Ur goes to Maluba and blesses it most generously with trees and reeds, oxen and birds, gold, tin and bronze. Following this, he provides Dilmun, Ilum, Mabashi and Matu with their needs, after which we find Enki in his boat once again, all set to decree the fates. Enki now turns from the fate and destiny of the various lands which made up the Sumerian inhabited world and performs a whole series of acts vital to the earth's fertility and productiveness. Directing himself first to its physical features, begins by filling the Tigris with fresh, sparkling, life-giving water. In the concrete metaphorical imagery of a poet, Enki is a rampant bull who mates with the river imagined as a wild cow. Then, to ensure that the Tigris and Euphrates function properly, he appoints the god Enbululu, the canal inspector, to take charge of them. Enki next called the marshland and the canebrake, supplied them with reeds, and appointed a deity who loves. The name is illegible to take charge of them. He then turns to the sea, erects his holy shrine, and places the goddess Nanshi, the lady of Sirara, in charge. Finally, Enki called the life-giving rain made it come down on Earth, and put the storm god Ishkar in charge. Enki applied himself to the Earth's cultural needs. He attends to the plough, yoke, and furrow, and appoints Enlil's farmer, Enkimdu, in charge of them. He next calls the cultivated field, brings forth its varied grains and vegetables, and makes the grain goddess Ashnun responsible for them. He looks after the pickaxe and brick mold, and puts the brick god Kula in charge of them. He lays foundations, aligns the bricks, builds a house, and puts Mushdama, the great builder of Enlil, in charge. Leaving the farm, field, and house, Enki directs his attention to the high plain, covers it with green vegetation, multiplies its cattle, and makes Sumugan, the king of the mountains, responsible for them. He next directs stalls and sheepfolds, supplies them with the best fat and milk, and appoints the shepherd god Dumuzi to take charge of them. He fixes the borders, presumably of cities and states, sets up boundary stones, and appoints the sun god Utu in charge of the entire universe. Finally, Enki attends to that which is a woman's task, especially the weaving of cloth, and puts Utu, the goddess of clothing, in charge. The myth now takes a rather unexpected turn as the poet brings on the scene the ambitious and aggressive Inanna, who feels that she's been sighted and left with no special powers and prerogatives. Bitterly, she complains about Enlil's sister Aruru, alias Nintu, and her, Inanna's, sister goddesses, Ninisini, Ninmug, Nidaba, and Nanshi, have all received their respective powers and insignia, but that she, Inanna, has been singled out for neglectful and inconsiderate treatment. Enki seems to be put on the defensive by Inanna's complaint, and he tries to pacify her by pointing out that she's quite several special insignia and prerogatives. The crook staff and ward of stewardship, oracular responses regarding war and battle, the weaving and fashioning garments, the power to destroy the indestructible and to make perish the imperishable, as well as by giving her a special blessing. Following Enki's reply to Inanna, the poem closes with a four-line hymnal passage to Enlil. Another Enki myth tells an intricate yet somewhat obscure tale involving paradise land Dulmun, perhaps identified with ancient India. Briefly sketched, the plot of the Sumerian paradise myth, which treats gods, not humans, runs thus. Dulmun is a land that is pure, clean, and bright, a land of the living, which allows neither sickness nor death. What is lacking, however, is the fresh water so essential to animal and plant life. Therefore, the tremendous Sumerian water god Enki orders Utu, the sun god, to fill it with fresh water brought up from the earth. Dulmun is thus turned into a divine garden, green with fruit-laden fields and meadows. In this paradise of the gods, eight plants are made to sprout by Ninhursag, the great mother goddess of the Sumerians. Perhaps more originally, Mother Earth. She brings these plants into being only after an intricate process involving three generations of goddesses, all conceived by the water god and born so. Our poem repeatedly underlines without the slightest pain or travail. Because Enki wanted to taste them, his messenger, the two-faced god Isfrud, the Igigi grandmaster, plucks these precious plants one by one and gives them to his master, Enlil, who eats them each, which point that angered Ninhursag pronounces upon him the curse of death. She disappears from among the gods to make sure that she does not change her mind and relent. Enki's health fails, eight of his organs become sick. As Enki sinks fast, the great gods sit in the dust. Enlil, the air god, the king of the Sumerian gods, seems unable to cope with the situation, when up speaks the fox. If properly rewarded, he says to Enlil, he, the fox, will bring Ninhursag back. As good as his word, the fox succeeds. The relevant passage is unfortunately destroyed, in having the mother goddess return to the gods and heal the dying water god. She seats him by her vulva, and after inquiring which eight organs of his body ache him, she brings into existence eight corresponding healing deities, and Enki is brought back to life and health. Although our myth deals with a divine rather than a human paradise, it parallels the biblical paradise story. First, there is some reason to believe that the very idea of a paradise, a garden of the gods, is of Sumerian origin. The Sumerian paradise is located, according to our poem, in Dulmun. In this same Dulmun where later the Mesopotamians, the Semitic people who conquered the Sumerians, located their land of the living, the home of their immortals. Furthermore, there is a good sign that the biblical paradise is described as a garden planted eastward in Eden, from whose waters how the four world rivers, including the Tigris and Euphrates, may have been originally identical Dulmun, the Sumerian paradise land. Again, the passage in our poem describing the watering of Dulmun by the sun god with fresh water brought up from the earth is reminiscent of the biblical, "But there went up a mist from the earth and watered the whole face of the ground," Genesis 2-6. Enki's eating of the eight plants and the curse uttered against him for this misdeed recall the eating of the fruit of the tree of knowledge by Adam and Eve, and the curses pronounced against each of them for their sinful action. Without pain or travail, the birth of the goddesses illuminates the background of the curse against Eve, that it shall be her lot to conceive in sorrow. Perhaps the most exciting result of our comparative analysis of the Sumerian poem is the explanation which it provides for one of the most puzzling motifs in the biblical paradise story, the famous passage describing the fashioning of Eve, the mother of all living, from the rib of Adam. For why a rib? Why did the Hebrew storyteller find it more fitting to choose a rib rather than any of the other parts of the body for the fashioning of the woman whose name Eve, according to the biblical notion, means approximately "she who makes live"? The reason becomes quite clear if we assume a Sumerian literary background, such as that represented by our Dulmun poem, underlying the biblical paradise tale. For in our Sumerian poem, one of Enki's six members is the rib. Now, the Sumerian word for rib is ti, pronounced ti. Therefore, the goddess created for the healing of Enki's rib was called in Sumerian Ninti, the lady of the rib. The same Sumerian word ti also means to make live. The name Ninti may thus mean the lady who makes live, as well as the lady of the rib. Therefore, in Sumerian literature, the lady of the rib came to be identified with the lady who makes live through what may be termed a play of words. It was this, one of the most ancient of literary puns, which was carried over and perpetuated in the biblical paradise story. Although here, of course, it loses its validity, since the Hebrew word for rib and that for who makes live have nothing in common. There is also an Enkin and Hirsuk myth concerned with the creation of man from clay that is over the abyss. The story begins with a description of the difficulties of the gods in procuring their bread, especially, as might have been expected, after the female deities had come into being. The gods complain, but Enki, the water god, who, as the Sumerian god of wisdom, might have been expected to come to their aid, is lying asleep in the deep and cannot hear them. Thereupon, his mother, the primeval sea, the mother who gave birth to all the gods, brings the tears of the gods before Enki, saying, "Oh my son, rise from your bed for your work, what is wise? Fashion servants of the gods, may they produce their doubles." Enki gives the matter thought, leads forth the host of good and princely fashioners, and says to his mother, Namu, the primeval sea, "Oh my mother, the creature whose name you uttered, it exists. Bind upon it the image of the gods. Mix the heart of the clay that is over the abyss. The excellent and princely fashioners will thicken the clay. You, do you bring the limbs into existence. Ninma, the earth mother goddess, will work above you. The goddess will stand by you at your fashioning." The poem now turns from the creation of man to the creation of certain imperfect human types to explain the existence of these abnormal beings. It tells of a feast arranged by Enki for the gods, no doubt to commemorate man's creation. At this feast, Enki and Ninma drink a lot of wine and become somewhat exuberant. Ninma then takes some clay over the abyss and fashions different abnormal individuals, while Enki decrees their fate and gives them bread to eat. After Ninma had created these six types of man, Enki creates his own. Going about it is not clear, but whatever he does, the resulting creature is a failure. It is weak in body and spirit. Enki is now anxious that Ninmub help this forlorn creature. He, therefore, addresses her. "Of him who your hand has fashioned, I have decreed the fate, have given him bread to eat. Do you decree the fate of him who in my hand has fashioned? Do you give him bread to eat?" Ninma tries to be good to the creature, but to no avail. She talks to him, but he cannot answer. She gives him bread to eat, but he does not reach out for it. He can neither sit nor stand, nor bend the knees. Following a long but yet unintelligible conversation between Enki and Ninma, the latter utters a curse against Enki because of the sick, lifeless creature which he produced, a curse which Enki seems to accept as his due. Of Ninurta, the god of the stormy south wind, there is a myth with a dragon-slaying motif. Following a brief hymnal passage to the god, the plot begins with an address to Ninurta by the Sharu, his personified weapon. For some unstated reason, the Sharur Bad set his mind against the Sug, the demon of sickness and disease whose abode is in the Kur, or Netherworld. In a full of phrases extolling the heroic qualities and deeds of Ninurta, he urges him to attack and destroy the monster. Ninurta sets out to do as bidden. At first, however, he seems to have met more than his match, and he flees like a bird. Once again, the Sharur addresses him with reassuring and encouraging words. Ninurta now attacks the Asug fiercely with all the weapons at his command, and the demon is destroyed. With the destruction of the Asug, however, a severe calamity overtook Sumer. The primeval waters of the Kur rose to the surface, and because of their violence, no fresh waters could reach the fields and gardens. The gods of Sumer, who queried its pickaxe and basket, that is, who had charge of irrigating Sumer and preparing it for cultivation, were desperate. The Tigris did not rise, it had no good water in its channel. Famine was severe, nothing was produced. There was no washing of the hands at the small rivers, the waters rose not high. The fields are not watered, there were no digging of irrigation ditches, in all the lands there was no vegetation, only weeds grew. Thereupon the Lord put his lofty mind to it. Ninurta the son of Enlil brought great things into being. He set up a pile of stones over the Kur and heaped it up like a great wall in front of Sumer. These stones held back the mighty waters, and as a result the waters of the Kur could rise no longer to the surface of the earth. As for waters which had already flooded the land, Ninurta gathered them and led them into the Tigris, which can now water the fields with its overbow. Alternatively, as the poet puts it, what had been scattered, he gathered. What of the Kur had been scattered, he guided and hurled into the Tigris. The high waters pour over the fields. Behold now, everything on earth. Rejoiced afar at Ninurta, the king of the land, the fields produced abundant grain. The vineyard and orchard bore their fruit. The harvest was heaped up in granaries and hills. The Lord made mourning to disappear from the land. He made happy the spirit of the gods. Hearing of her son's tremendous and heroic deeds, his mother's Nimma was taken with love for him. She became so restless that she could not sleep in her bedchamber. She therefore addresses Ninurta from afar with a prayer for permission to visit him and gaze upon him. Ninurta looks at her with the eye of life, just like his ancestors of Nibiru. Ninurta then blesses the Hursug that it may produce all kinds of herbs, wine and honey, various kinds of trees, gold, silver and bronze, cattle, sheep and all four-legged creatures. Following this blessing, he turns to the stones, cursing those who had been his enemies in battle with the Asug demon and blessing those who had been his friends. Not a few Sumerian myths revolve about the ambitious, aggressive and demanding goddess of love, Inanna, the Akkadian Ishtar, and her husband, the shepherd god Dumuzi, the biblical Tammuz. The wooing of the goddess by Dumuzi is told in two versions. He contends for her favour with the farmer god Enkimdu, and is successful only after a good deal of quarrelsome argument leading to threats of violence. On the other hand, Dumuzi seems to find ready and immediate acceptance as Inanna's lover and husband. Little did he dream that his marriage to Inanna would end in his perdition, and that he would be dragged down to the underworld. This is told in one of the best preserved Sumerian myths, Inanna's descent to the netherworld, which has been published and revised 3 times in the course of the past 25 years, and it is about to be revised a 4th time with the help of several hitherto unknown tablets and fragments. It tells the following tale. Inanna, Queen of Heaven, the ambitious goddess of love and war, whom the shepherd Dumuzi had wooed and won for wife, descends to the netherworld to make herself its mistress, and thus perhaps to raise the dead. She therefore collects the appropriate divine laws, and having adorned herself with her queenly robes and jewels, she is ready to enter the land of no return. The queen of the netherworld is her older sister and bitter enemy, Erishkigal, Sumerian goddess of death and gloom. Fearing, not without reason, lest her sister put her to death in the domain she rules, Inanna instructs her vizier, Nishubar, who is always at her beck and call, that if after 3 days she has failed to return, he is to set up a lament for her by the ruins, in the assembly hall of the gods. He is then to go to Nippur, the city of Enlil, the leading god of the Sumerian pantheon, and plead with him to save her, and not let her be put to death in the netherworld. If Enlil refuses, Nishubar is to go to Ur, the city of the moon god, Nanna, and repeat his plea. Nanna too refuses. He is to go to Eridu, the city of Enlil, the god of wisdom, who knows the food of life, who knows the water of life, and he will surely come to her rescue. Inanna then descends to the netherworld and approaches Ereshkigal's temple of lapis lazuli. At the gate, she is met by the chief gatekeeper, who demands to know who she is and why she has come. Inanna concocts a false excuse for a visit, and the gatekeeper, on instructions from his mistress, leads her through the seven gates to the netherworld. As she passes through one gate after another, her garments and jewels are removed piece by piece, despite her protests. Finally, after entering the last gate, she is brought stark naked and on bended knees before Ereshkigal and the Anunnaki, the seven dreaded judges of the netherworld. 3 days and three nights pass. On the fourth day, Ninsubu, seeing that his mistress has not returned, makes the rounds of the gods following her instructions. As Inanna had surmised, both Enlil and Nanna refuse all help. Enki, however, devises a plan to restore her to life. He fashions the Kurgaru and the Kalatu, two sexless creatures, and entrusts them to the food of life and the water of life, with instructions to proceed to the netherworld where Ereshkigal, the birth-giving mother, lies sick. Though Inanna is once again alive, her troubles are far from over. For I was an unbroken rule of the land of no return, that no one who had entered its gates might return to the world above unless he produced a substitute to take his place in the netherworld. Inanna is no exception to the rule. He is indeed permitted to reascend to the earth, but is accompanied by several restless demons, with instructions to bring her back to the lower regions if she cannot provide another deity to take her place. Surrounded by these ghoulish constables, Inanna first visits the two Sumerian cities, Uma and Bad-Tibira. The protecting gods of these cities, Shara and Latharak, terrified at the sight of the unearthly arrivals, clothe themselves in sackcloth and grovel in the dust before Inanna. Inanna seems to be gratified by their humility, and when the demons threaten to carry them off to the netherworld, she restrains the demons, and thus saves the lives of the two gods. Inanna and the Igigi, continuing their journey, arrive at Kulab, a district in the Sumerian city-state of Erech. The king of the city is the shepherd god Dumuzi. He, instead of bewailing the fact that his wife had descended to the netherworld when she'd suffered torture and death, put on a noble robe, sat on a high throne. He was celebrating and rejoicing. Enraged, Inanna looks down upon him with the eye of death and hands him over to the eager and unmerciful demons to be carried off to the netherworld. Dumuzi turns pale and weeps. He lifts his hands to the sky and pleads with the sun god Utu, who is Inanna's brother, and therefore his brother-in-law. Dumuzi begs Utu to help him escape the clutches of the demons by changing his hand into the hand of a snake and his foot into the foot of a snake. Right in the middle of Dumuzi's prayer, the tablets break off and the reader is left hanging in midair. Now, however, we have the low end. Despite the three-time intervention of Utu, Dumuzi is carried off to die in the netherworld as a substitute for his angered and embittered wife, Inanna. This we learn from a hitherto unknown poem which is not part of the Inanna's descent to the netherworld, but is intimately related to it, and which, moreover, speaks of Dumuzi's changing into a gazelle rather than a snake. This new composition has been found inscribed on 28 tablets and fragments dating from about 1750 BC. The full text has only recently been pieced together and translated, at least tentatively, although some pieces were published decades ago. The first of the pieces belonging to the myth were published as early as 1915 by a young Sumerologist, Hugo Radau, but it contained only the poem's last lines, and its contents, therefore, remained obscure. In 1999, the French scholar Ryan Moorhen published two additional pieces that contained the poem's initial 55 lines. Since the entire middle portion was unknown, there was no way of knowing that Ryan Moorhen's pieces belonged to the same person. By 2003, six additional pieces, published and unpublished, became available, and Thorki Jacobsen of the Oriental Institute, one of the world's leading Sumerologists, was the first to show its plot and to translate several passages in the Journal of Cuneiform Studies, and Leo Oppenheim's The Interpretation of Dreams in the Ancient Near East. Since then, I've identified 19 additional tablets and fragments, 10 of which are in the Museum of the Ancient Orient in Istanbul. These have been copied by Nora Romney, the curators of the tablet collection in Istanbul, and myself. Because of all these new documents, it was possible, at long last, to restore the text of the poem almost in full, and to prepare the tentative translation on which the following sketch of its contents is based. The myth begins with an introductory passage in which the author sets the melancholy tone of the tale he is to tell Dumuzi, the shepherd of Erech, has a foreboding premonition that his death is imminent, and so goes forth to the plain with tearful eyes and bitter lament. His heart was filled with tears, and he went from earth to the plain. The shepherd, his heart was filled with tears, and he went forth to the plain. Dumuzi, his heart was filled with tears, he went forth to the plain. He fastened his flute about his neck, gave utterance to a lament. Set up a lament, set up a lament. Dumuzi, the poem continues, then lies down to sleep and has an ominous and foreboding dream. He lay down among the buds. He dreamt a dream. He arose. It was a dream. He trembled. It was a vision of Nibiru burning. He rubbed his eyes with his hands. He was dazed. The bewildered Dumuzi, now his sister, Gestanana, the divine poet, singer, and dream interpreter, brought before him and told her his portentous vision. My dream, O my sister, my dream, this is the heart of my dream. Nibiru burned deep red. One reed standing all alone bows its head for me. Of the reeds standing in pairs, one is removed for me. Gestanana thus interprets item by item her brother's somber and foreboding dream, ending with a warning that the demons of the netherworld, the Galas, are closing in on him, and that he must hide immediately. Dumuzi agrees and implores his sister not to tell the Galas of his hiding place. Thus, my friend, I will hide among the plants. Tell no one my hiding place, and I will hide among the small plants. Tell no one my hiding place. I will hide among the large plants. Tell no one my hiding place. I will hide among ditches of Aralu. Tell no one my hiding place. Come searching for the hidden Dumuzi, but cannot find him. They seize his sister, Gestanana, and try to bribe her to tell them of Dumuzi's whereabouts, but she remains faithful to her, given the word. Dumuzi, however, returns to the city, probably because he fears the Anunnaki of Nibiru will take his sister. There, the Galas catch hold of him, belabor him with blows, punches, and lashes, bind fast his hands and arms, and are all set to carry him off to the netherworld. After that, Dumuzi turns to the sun god Utu, the brother of his wife, Inanna, the tutelary goddess of his city, Erech, with the prayer to turn him into a gazelle that he can escape the Galas and carry off his soul to a place as yet unidentified, known by the name of Shubarila, or, as Dumuzi himself puts it, Utu, you are my wife's brother. I am your sister's husband. I am he who carries food for Yana, Inanna's temple. In Erech, I perform the worship of Nibiru. The sun god hearkened to Dumuzi's prayer. In the words of the poet, Utu took his tears as a gift. But to no avail, the pursuing Igigi caught up with him once again and beat and tortured him as before. A second time, therefore, Dumuzi turns to the sun god Utu with a prayer to turn him into a gazelle, only this time he will carry off his soul to the house of a goddess known as Belili, the wise old lady. Utu does so, and Dumuzi arrives at the house of Belili, pleading. Wise old lady, I am not a man, I am the husband of a goddess. Of the abated water, let me drink a little. Of the flour which has sprinkled, let me eat a little. He had barely had time to partake of food and drink when the Galas appear and beat and torment Dumuzi a third time. Again, Utu turns him to a gazelle, and he escapes to the sheepfold of his sister Gestanana. All in vain, five of the Galas enter the sheepfold, strike Dumuzi on the cheek with nails and sticks, and Dumuzi dies. Alternatively, to quote the melancholy lines which end the poem, the first Gala enters the council of Nibiru. He strikes Dumuzi on the cheek with a piercing nail. The second one enters the council of Nibiru. He strikes Dumuzi on the cheek with a shepherd's crook. The third one enters the council of Nibiru. Thus, Dumuzi comes to a tragic end, a victim of Inanna's love and bait. Not all the Inanna myths, however, relate to Dumuzi. There is one, for example, which relates Bao, the goddess obtained through trickery, the divine laws and inerta which govern humankind and his institutions. This myth is of considerable and anthropological interest. Because its author found it desirable in connection with the story to give a complete list of the Nibiru moons, he divided civilization as to be conceived it into over 100 culture traits and complexes relating to man's political and religious and social institutions, to the arts and crafts, to music and musical instruments, and to a varied assortment of intellectual, emotional, and social patterns of behavior. Briefly sketched, the plot of this revealing myth runs. Inanna, Queen of Heaven, the tutelary goddess of Erech, is eager to increase her city's welfare and prosperity, make it the center of Sumerian civilization, and thus exalt her name and fame. She therefore goes to Eridu, the ancient and hoary seat of a Sumerian culture, where Enki, the Lord of Wisdom, who knows the very heart of the gods, dwells in his watery abyss, the Abzu. For Enki was under his charge all the divine decrees that are fundamental to civilization. Furthermore, if she can obtain them, by fair means or foul, and bring them to her city Erech, its glory and her own will indeed be unsurpassed. As she approaches the Abzu of Eridu, Enki, no doubt taken in by her charm, calls his messenger, Isimud, whom he addresses. Come to my messenger and hear my instructions. A word I shall say to you, take my word. The maid all alone has directed her steps to the Abzu. Inanna, all alone, has directed her step to the Abzu. Have the maid enter the Abzu of Eridu. Give her to eat barley cake with butter. Pour for the cold water that freshens the heart. Give her to drink beer in the face of the lion at the holy table, the table of heaven. Speak to Inanna's words of greeting for the council of Nibiru. Simul did exactly as bidden by his master, and Inanna and Enki sit down to feast and banquet. After their hearts have become happy with drink, Enki exclaims, by the name of power, by the name of my power, to holy Inanna, my daughter, I shall present the divine decrees. He thereupon presents, several at a time, the over 100 divine decrees which, according to our author, control the cultural pattern of civilization as he knew it. Inanna is happy to accept the gifts offered her by the drunken Enki. She takes them, loads them on her boat of heaven, and makes off for Erech with her precious cargo. After the effects of the banquet had worn off, Enki noticed that Ninurta's Anunnaki artifacts were gone from their usual place. He turns to Isimud, and the latter informs him he, Enki himself, had presented them to his daughter, Inanna. The upset Enki rues his munificence and prevents the boat of heaven from reaching Erech at all cost. Therefore, he dispatches his messenger, Isernud, and a group of sea monsters to follow Inanna and her boat to the first of the seven stepping stations between the Abzu of Eridu and Erech. Here, the sea monsters are to seize the boat of heaven from Inanna. Inanna herself, however, must be permitted to continue her journey to Erech on foot. Isimud does as bidden. He overtakes Inanna and the boat of heaven and informs her of Enki's change of heart, and that while she is free to go on to Erech, he will have to take the boat and its precious cargo from her and bring it back to Erech. After that, Inanna berates End roundly for breaking his word and oath. She turns to her vizier, the god Ninshubur, for help, and the latter rescues her and the boat from Isimud, the sea monsters. Enki is persistent. Again and again, he sends Isimud accompanied by various sea monsters to seize the boat of heaven. On each occasion, Ninshubur comes to the rescue of his mistress. Finally, Inanna and her boat arrive safe and sound at Erech, where, amidst jubilation and feasting by the delighted inhabitants, she unloads the precious divine Ninurta, one at a time.